Hey guys, NerdKing101 here, and welcome to my review of Ant-Man and the Wasp. So I want to start out by saying, flat out, this is a fantastic movie, and you should all go watch it. You probably already have seen it, but if for some reason you haven't, go watch this movie. This movie is fantastic. The acting is great. In fact, this movie made me love Paul Rudd as Ant-Man. Before I was like, he's fine, Ant-Man was fine. This movie made me love the Ant-Man character in these movies. Because before that, I mean, I liked the first Ant-Man, but it was nothing like this. I do want to give credit to the child actor who played his daughter, Cassie, I believe her name is. I want to give her credit. I don't know her name, but she was great. All the actors in this were great. They were fantastic. There were no acting problems in this movie. The humor in this. While I've never had a problem with the Marvel movies and their humor, I know some people have, and I can kind of see why. It's very repetitive and quippy, and I can see why you would have a problem with it. And this movie has that kind of humor, but it also has some humor that is just really funny. I found myself laughing a lot during this movie. I want to say more than I normally would during a Marvel movie. I honestly believe I laughed more during this than during most of the Marvel movies. The villain, Ghost was fantastic. Coming off of Thanos, I figured it would be hard to top because Thanos was incredible. Thanos was great, he was the best villain in the MCU. And then before him, we had Killmonger. And I was like, how can you top this? These are fantastic villains. And I'll be honest, they didn't top it. Ghost is nowhere near Killmonger or Thanos. But Ghost is unique and she's interesting. I really like how this is the first time that I can think of in the Marvel movies. Mind you, there have been 19 of these. I could be forgetting something. But that we've had a really sympathetic villain. And you kind of wonder, do you want her to win? Like Thanos, yeah, he was kind of sympathetic. But we were never like, yeah, Thanos kill half the universe. With Ghost, you kind of look at her and you're kind of like, well, she's just a kid trying to stay alive. She's like, what, an 18-year-old girl and she's just trying not to die? So you can kind of respect that. She's young and she just doesn't want to die. And you can kind of get behind her. There were points where I was kind of like, isn't it a little selfish to try to save this old woman and take a chance with this like 18-year-old girl's life? I kind of like that didn't seem right to me at times. And I'm glad it worked out for both parties in the end. But that I really enjoyed because it made me question who was in the right. It's something you don't normally do when you're in a Marvel movie. That's something very few pieces of media can do. So I applaud the movie for doing that. The special effects and action in this movie are great. One of my favorite things is the thing where he's in the boat and he comes out of the water and he's like 100 feet tall and it is so cool. I also like how they implemented a weakness to that. He can't just grow 100 feet tall. It made him dizzy and messes with his brain. So he can't really do it, but he like fell over and nearly died. But that was cool. I also really liked the way they handled the stakes in this movie. Most Marvel movies, it's like, we gotta save the universe. We gotta save the country or the city or the planet. Like, the Avengers have to do this or this. This movie, the big consequence, if he lost, he would be arrested and he wouldn't be able to see his daughter for 20 years. So it was a very realistic, simple stake. It wasn't like the world was in danger or anything like that. It was very self-contained, and you could easily see why the other Avengers weren't involved, because the police and the FBI were handling it. But I liked how it wasn't like the world was in danger. It was a nice change of pace after stuff like Black Panther, Ragnarok, Guardians of the Galaxy, Doctor Strange, Avengers Infinity War. After those last chunk of movies, besides Spider-Man Homecoming, have all been, like, end-of-the-world stories. This was a nice story about a father trying to do the right thing, and it was interesting. I liked the dynamic between him and his daughter. I especially liked the opening scene where they're pretending to, like, rob a bank or something together, and they get away on the big ant because she thinks Ant-Man is really cool, and they get to go down the cardboard slide, and he's just having fun with a kid, and he's under house arrest from Civil War. Now, what I do want to mention involves the post-credit scene. So basically, they do explain in this movie, in the post-credit scene, where Ant-Man was during Avengers Infinity War. He was testing out some technology with Hank Pym, Janet Van Dyne, and Hope. They were testing out some technology, and while he was inside the Quantum Realm, the Battle of Wakanda was taking place while they were doing that, and while he was inside of it, Thanos snaps his finger, and Janet Van Dyne, Hope, and Hank Pym died. They turned to dust. So what I'm assuming is that in Avengers 4, Iron Man and all of them are going to gather together on Earth, and they're going to find Ant-Man, or he'll escape on his own or something. But what I'm assuming is that he will be involved in Avengers 4, or they're just going to leave him there until after the Avengers bring everybody back. Because let's be honest, we know they're going to bring everybody back. One thing that did bother me is that I had seen titles on YouTube regarding the post-credit scenes that kind of built them up to be super important, and really they weren't. The only one that really matters is the first one where everybody turns to dust and dies. Because the next one is just a gag, it's a joke. And I will admit, I'm annoyed when the Marvel movies do that. They have plenty of stuff going on in here to have two post-credit scenes. Sometimes they just don't do it, and if they're not going to have, like, an interesting post-credit scene, then just don't have one. Dude, you know what? Some people have been sitting for, like, 2 hours and 30 minutes, and they want to go to the bathroom, like me. I really badly had to use the restroom, and I waited. And after, like, 5 or 6 minutes for those credits to roll, just to see nothing. It was a lot like the Spider-Man Homecoming thing with Captain America. Like, don't you feel cheated? And I don't like it when Marvel does that. But, yeah, overall, I loved Ant-Man and the Wasp. I'm not going to go too deep into the story, but to be completely honest, the one thing that I don't love about this movie is that the story is kind of bland. Like the actual narrative, it had interesting villains with interesting motivations and interesting characters with interesting motivations. But overall, the actual story is really, really simple. They want to get Hank Pym's dead wife back. Well, not dead, but they want to get Janet Van Dyne back from the Quantum Realm. And the FBI and Ghost want to use that technology for different reasons. So there's just a ton of factions trying to steal the lab with that technology in it, and they have to keep the lab safe and perform the experiment. That's really the entire story. That's basically it. There is a subplot that is kind of like a romance subplot between Hope and Scott, but I'm going to be completely honest with you. It's not a major part of the story in any way. In fact, it feels very natural in the sense that there is a romance between the two of them, and that's it. They don't have special scenes for it too often. There's a couple of them, but those are mostly played for comedic effect. There's one scene where they kiss and it fits, and it works, and it's during the action. So it's not like they took a break from the story so they could have these two kiss. So the romance subplot was fine. It fit in really well. And that is really all I have to say on this movie. Ant-Man and the Wasp is a very self-contained movie, and it's probably the Marvel movie that I'm going to have the least to say about. I'm definitely going to have more to say probably about something like Captain Marvel or Avengers 4. This just feels very, like, it's there. Like, they need to make an Ant-Man sequel, so they made a really good Ant-Man sequel. But that's all it is. It's not like a big, expansive movie where I need to talk about all the other ways it can play into the MCU, or where an Infinity Stone is, or none of that to talk about. It's just a fun movie. So if you want to go have some fun and laugh and see some good action, some good special effects, go check out Ant-Man and the Wasp if you haven't already. I would give it a 4.5 out of 5. I really have no problem with it, besides for the fact that when it comes to the story, there isn't much going on there. But even then, the great characters with great motivations, and the great humor, and the great action and special effects all make up for that. So definitely go check it out. If you liked the video, leave it a like, and subscribe for more videos like this one. If you want to see more Marvel videos relating to the MCU, or maybe even the comics a little bit, tell me in the comment section down below, and maybe I'll start doing some of that. We'll see. Have a great day, guys.